thank you for joining us this afternoon. I'll start by introducing ourselves. I'm Craig Borthwick. I'm a lawyer in the funds team here at Dechert in London. I'm joined by a panel with Dunya and Phil from Dubai and Chris, who acts across both jurisdictions, both London and Dubai. We're working a lot with UAE managers at the moment in terms of establishing presence in the UAE. So the reason for this seminar is a response to the quite dramatic increase in interest we're seeing from fund managers in terms of setting up a presence in Dubai for investment management purposes, but also for raising capital from investors in Dubai and the Middle East generally. I think the increase in interest is primarily driven by the fact the UAE offers a favorable jurisdiction in terms of tax. It's a business-friendly jurisdiction, high-quality financial center, political stability, a good legal system based primarily on the UK system, and it's got good links to Asia and the Middle East. I think it's also fair to say that the credibility of the jurisdiction has been increased dramatically by the likes of Citadel, Millennium, Alliance Bernstein, Exodus Point, many others moving to the jurisdiction, which has probably helped some of the smaller managers and the medium managers say, well, actually, this is a credible place to do business. So I think some of those guys that probably in the past were not willing to move to Dubai or thought that there was potentially client perception issues with being in Dubai are now seeing Dubai as a more credible jurisdiction in which to base themselves. I think it's true to say as well that the UK management sector as well is increasingly interesting in Dubai. We're seeing in particular a lot of UK managers a bit fed up with the tax rates out in the UK, looking at Dubai and saying, well, this is a very favorable jurisdiction to base ourselves from a tax perspective. So and I think the lack of political stability here at the moment, the high inflation is driving further managers to the region and the UAE. So I think that's one key driver. We're also seeing a lot of Singapore managers, Hong Kong managers, Russian managers, again, for political reasons, moving from their jurisdictions to the UAE. So that again, is driving the interest in the area. Aside from setting up investment management presence in Dubai, we're seeing a lot of interest in setting up local fund products as well to raise capital from the Middle Eastern and UAE investors. So that's kind of the scene setting. In terms of outlining the content of this seminar, we're going to cover three main topics. First, we're going to look at some of the key issues to consider in establishing a presence in the UAE, whether that be for investment management purposes or for marketing purposes. Second, we'll look at the key rules applicable to marketing to UAE investors. And third, we're going to look at some of the key features of local fund products, whether that be ADGM funds, DIFC local funds, or onshore UAE funds. Before we start, and do feel free to decline to answer, but how many in this room are actually currently actively considering relocating or setting up a presence in Dubai? So 3, 4, 5. Okay.
Try and get the number up.
Yeah, that's your job. okay, so we'll start with establishing a regulated presence in Dubai. This is, you know, we're focused here on setting up a management business, like a branch or rep office in Dubai. Before we get into the key requirements of setting up a, you know, investment management or marketing office in Dubai, Chris, perhaps you can explain what we mean by DIFC, ADGM. Yeah.
Let's go. Fund lawyers like nothing more than an acronym. So for those of you who maybe only just starting to look at the region, the two main financial centers in which we do the majority of our work in the Middle East is the DIFC, Dubai International Financial Center, and ADGM, Abu Dhabi Global Markets. Dubai and Abu Dhabi, I think, have healthy competition with one another. So I suspect when Dubai set up the DIFC some 20 years ago, it was you were probably going to get fairly short odds on the fact that Abu Dhabi at some stage was going to think that they wanted exactly what Dubai wanted. So ADGM came along back in 2013. At DIFC, which is where we have an office, is the more established. You've got about 4,500 companies registered in the DIFC. Now, that doesn't mean you've got 4,500 businesses operating from there, because there's holding companies and other intermediate entities that are based out there. What you have got is just shy of 600 entities which have some sort of financial services license. So you've got the regulators, the DFSA, They use a regulatory handbook which bears a more than passing resemblance to the FCA handbook. I'm sure the FCA is aware that they're being flattered by that book being used in the DIFC. But what that does mean for both for us and for our clients who are coming from a UK regulatory background is that there's actually a lot of similarities and a lot of things that one recognises immediately when one is setting up in the DIFC. Craig's mentioned a couple of the players that have set up recently. You've had other managers like Jefferies, Nomura, Lord Abbott, LMR, who've all set up in the DIFC over the past 18 months or so. For a long time, what was happening in the DIFC was a lot of sort of intermediation and sales offices that has now switched a little bit more to actual assets being managed out of the region or out of the DIFC. So you've got about $450 billion at the last count of assets being managed out of the DIFC. There was a statement by one of the senior members of the regulator recently that they reckon they've got hedge fund managers who are managing about $1 trillion who are looking, actively looking or at some stage in their journey of actively looking at setting up in the DIFC. So, we're talking fairly significant numbers. And then next to the hedge fund managers, you've got a lot of focus on things like fintech and other sort of innovation, which is trying to get into DIFC. If you sort of move 120 kilometers down the coast, you get to Abu Dhabi. As I said, a little bit of a younger jurisdiction, similar number of total licenses. Again, the sort of 5,000 something licenses will be masking a lot of holdcos. They have attracted of late names such as Brevan Howard and then Binance and others in the sort of blockchain and fintech space. We don't have an office in the ADGM, so we do everything from the DIFC. But as Phil and Dooney are going to explain to you, we do ADGM products. The other three-letter acronym before I hand back to Craig is ESCA. That's the onshore regulator for the UAE. As you'll probably know, there's an awful lot of free zones in Dubai, which all have their own individual regimes as far as laws and taxation or lack of taxation is concerned. So ESCA is the regulator that is effectively governing financial services that are not covered by any of the free zones, which includes DIFC.
Thank you. So Phil, can you now cover, so for fund managers seeking to set up in DIFC or ADGM, whether for investment management purposes or marketing purposes, what activities require regulation or are regulated, which require authorization, and what are the authorizations available to managers?
Yeah, so it's fairly similar to the UK regime. So our financial promotions is a regulated activity. So if you are marketing physically or actively in the region, then you would need to be authorized. So some of the conversations that I have on a regular basis with clients are, well, we just want to do X or we just want to do Y, what license should we go for? So I think we see, there's probably three main licenses that we see. We see managers get a rep office. So for those managers who just want to be sort of, dip their toes in the region, they might just have one or two people, mainly just sales, marketing, then you would opt for the rep office. And the rep office, all it can do is market products and financial services that the group is licensed to do elsewhere. There can't be any client onboarding, can't receive and send documents. So it's purely a marketing office, and you sort of just make referrals back to the home office. So that's the rep office, and that's the same in both the DIFC and the ADGM. The next license above is the Category 4 license, and that's for advising and arranging. So often we have a discussion with the client about, how they operate. And it may be that they just want to do marketing and sales, but the way they operate, can quickly trigger them into arranging. So if from a client relationship perspective, you want to be sending, receiving sub docs, helping them fill out the docs, you know, having a dedicated client relationship person, then you need to be opting for a Cat 4 with arranging and possibly advising on the license. And then the next license up is the Category 3 license, which is asset management and fund management. So the difference between Cat 3 and Cat 4, non-discretionary management advisory is Cat 4, and then discretionary management is Category 3. So you know, if you wanted to set up a locally domiciled fund, so either DIFC or ADGM fund, then you must go for the Category 3 license. Or if you've got doing actual portfolio management out of the DIFC or ADGM, again, you would need the Category 3 license. So we see sort of a mixture. We see, you know, a pretty even split between rep officers, Cat 3s, Cat 4s, depending on what the clients want to do. I mean, I think one thing to note, as Chris mentioned before, you know, probably 5-6 years ago, I've been in Dubai since 2010. So I think, you know, we saw a lot of the larger managers, you know, they would just have a rep office or a Cat 4 license. And it was really just a couple of salespeople out in the region. But in the last couple of years, we've been seeing, you know, whole teams of portfolio managers actually moving to Dubai and ADGM. So I think that's been the big difference. You know, one of our clients this year has moved 25 traders from their Lux office. They're all sitting in Dubai now. So that's the big difference. I think it's a bit of a snowball effect. You know, there's mentioned some also Apollo just set up in ADGM. So, you know, I think a lot of people are looking at the region. We've never been busier. The regulators have never been busier. They're trying to hire people themselves. So applications are taking a lot longer, unfortunately, just because there's a record number of applications in front of the regulator.
Do you know the number at the moment?
Not sure, but we're, you know, working on several at the moment in both jurisdictions. It wouldn't be able to know how many applications it actually got. But I think the number of licenses that were issued in 2022 was up 20% from 2021. So it's and they expect the same sort of number again.
Because we had a probably about 5-6 years ago, we had a spin out looking to set up in Dubai, and they were really toying between staying in London versus going to Dubai. And there was this real concern that actually, if you're in Dubai, you're not near investors, it's not seen as such a credible jurisdiction. But that just seems to have dissipated now, because the big multi-managers in particular going out there. Yeah. And I think it's a lot of, particularly in the public securities world, if you're running money, particularly for a brand name which is not your own brand name, why not just run the money in a tax favorable jurisdiction? So,
and they also didn't mention the weather's slightly better in the UAE. But yeah, I think, you know, the other reason that we're seeing, you know, a lot of managers looking at ADGM as opposed to DIFC is the sovereigns are writing big checks and saying, well, if you set up a presence here, which means you have to have your fund management license and you set up an ADGM fund, then we're seeing them writing up to sort of $200 million checks to managers to attract them to the ADGM. We're not seeing that so much in DIFC. But certainly the sovereigns in Abu Dhabi are very active and seeding a lot of the funds at the moment.
So going back to the application process, you know, what is the timing? What are the substance requirements? How easy is it to obtain these licenses?
Yeah, so as I mentioned, unfortunately, it is taking longer at the moment. So starting with the rep office, we just got one for a European manager. That took about 4 months. I think a year or two ago, basically the timeframes probably doubled. So rep office, you're looking at sort of 4-5 months. Category 4, you're looking at 5-7 months. Category 3, you're looking at 6-9 months, depending on, you know, your operations elsewhere and whether you can leverage off that. So we also set up a Cat 3A, which is a prime brokerage for a prime broker, and that took 14 months. So the timeframes are being pushed out, unfortunately.
And the substance?
Substance. So for all of these licenses, you need a physical office. So it's also a bit of a real estate play from the governments. And so a physical office and you have to have real staff. So with a a rep office, you can get away with just one person, which would be the authorized representative. For a Cat 4 and Cat 3, you know, you need your compliance officer, your finance officer, your MLRO, you'll need a senior executive officer. And then if you're running a fund, you will need at least one or two fund managers as well. So you have to have real substance. And you know, the regular, it's not largely different from, I think, the UK licensing regime. And a lot of the regulators at the DFC and FSRA are ex-FCA. And they liaise quite a lot.
It might be worth saying, I think it's quite a hands-on regulator, right, from an ongoing monitoring perspective, because the DIFC, you can sort of walk across it, you know, in 20 minutes, which means you're never more than 10 minutes from a regulator, which may be a good thing or a bad thing. But, you know, we have got lots of stories from, you know, clients who have the regulator turning up unannounced because they can just wander down in 5 minutes and, you know, want to look at your client ontake KYC documentation to make sure you've done the right client classifications, which of course anyone is going to want to do properly anyway. But, you know, there is, I think, a slightly more practical approach, right, taken by the DFSA on how they monitor their regulated entities. And I don't know, Phil, whether this is a story which has, you know, gone into the distant past along with a fax machine, but I know when, so I started going out there in 2015, and we were doing a couple of applications, and at the time, one of the conditions to the license being granted was that you obviously had to put in the phone number of the regulated entity, and the regulator would come around with a mobile phone and phone the phone number and make sure the phone that you'd said was going to ring was actually going to ring, because they were getting into amazing amounts of detail to make sure that whatever substance you said you had, you know, really did exist. So
yeah, that's right. Even now, so you know, to get the license, you obviously have to have physical office space. So they will come in, and before they give you the final license, they'll pick up phones, make sure there's a dial tone. They'll check your servers. They interview everyone. So it is a fairly hands-on approach. They want people physically in the region. One of the questions we do get asked is, well, if I'm the SCO, for example, of the entity, how long, you know, do I have to be physically located in, say, the DIFC office? And there's nothing in the regulations, but we advise clients that, you know, effectively follow like you would on a taxation basis. You should, the SCO and the key officers should really be there at least a majority of the time. So we say at least 181 days a year as a general rule. The regulators, they don't really audit that. You know, they've been a bit more flexible since COVID, but I think now we're, you know, moving past that. So there is an expectation that people are spending a majority of their time in the office. A lot of the roles, like compliance officer, finance officer, they can all be outsourced and be part time. But the key people, like the SCO and any portfolio managers, would be expected to be in the office a majority.
Which probably brings us quite nicely to the next question, which is, in the UK, we're quite familiar with the kind of like regulatory hosts. So often in the UK, instead of getting your own license, you're operate under the license of someone else and their supervisor activities. Is that a route that's available to managers in Dubai?
I think it's the authorized rep.
Yeah. Well, there's two parts. There's authorized rep for investment advice and certain market activities. And then you've got the kind of portfolio management side, yeah, which is the, you know, in the name of the regulatory host.
Yeah. So there's no sort of equivalent of the authorized rep arrangement. But there are, I guess, fund management platforms. So effectively like AIFMs for hire, but it's not as, I guess, well advanced or as sophisticated, say Luxembourg. There's only a couple of players at the moment. So it is possible. So we see a lot of smaller managers will approach some of these platforms, and effectively, probably similar to what they do in the UK, that, you know, the people are seconded to the licensed manager. They pay an annual fee, and so we'll set up, you know, usually it's done so that they can manage a fund, but sometimes they do it for capital raising as well. So they'd be seconded into the licensed entity and have their business cards, their phone numbers, etc., and then be operate under the that umbrella, licensed umbrella.
I suppose we'd expect to see a growth in that market as more people go to the area. Because yeah. It might be easy enough for someone like Citadel to get their own license and staff it with substance, but some of the more entrepreneurial managers probably need some assistance.
Yeah, I think the smaller managers, the startups, definitely looking for the platform. But also we've seen a couple of larger managers where it's not an issue of cost, but it's an issue of timing. And they, you know, really need to get a fund up and running quickly. So we worked with a large real estate manager recently, and they opted to go onto the platform just for the first 6 months while they were applying for their own license, and then we just switched them over. So we are also, it's just from a timing perspective, we see larger managers going to the platforms as well.
Wait, so go back to you, Chris. In terms of our client base, UK managers, how are we seeing UK managers structure their arrangements with Dubai or DIFC or AGM kind of managers and marketing rep office, offices? How's that structured from a regulatory perspective, tax perspective?
Yeah, so I think the structures, if you're doing portfolio management out of Dubai, then I think you've got two options. You'd either have a fund, whether that's a Cayman fund or a Luxembourg fund, whatever it is, which is engaging both the UK manager and then in parallel the DIFC manager, so they're managing separate sleeves of the same fund. I think what is more common is a delegation model where the UK entity will be the sort of primary manager, and then it delegates down to the DIFC entity, or indeed it could be a Luxembourg fund with a Luxembourg AFIM, which is delegating to the Dubai entity. And which one you choose, I think, is going to be a combination of tax issues, the regulatory treatment you're going to get, and just the reality of how you're wanting to manage that portfolio. So I guess from a UK entity, you want to make sure that your structure is not going to bust through the IME to the extent that what you're doing is a trading fund. And that you are, making sure that you're keeping, the right amount of fees in the UK entity and then in the Dubai entity. I think from a sort of structuring and ownership perspective, you want to look at whether you need a holdco. If you're sort of doing a clean sheet approach, are you going to have a holdco which is going to sit above your Dubai entity? And whether that works or not, I think depends on the location of the individuals who are going to be the sort of equity or shareholders. Or do you just have the Dubai entity held as a subsidiary, maybe of your existing UK asset manager? What is more efficient from a tax perspective, again, is going to turn on where, the individuals who are going to hold the equity are sitting. Are they going to remain in the UK? Or actually is what's happening that, you are moving a team across to Dubai and people are going to be based in Dubai full time, in which case UK tax issues, become less relevant. I think from a regulatory perspective, again, assuming you've got a UK regulated firm and then you're applying for, the right level of authorization to do what you want to do in Dubai, some of the issues you want to think about is thinking about the nature of the activity that you're going to delegate from the UK to the DIFC entity, assuming we're going with a model where you've got a UK manager delegating down to the DIFC or ADGM entity, I should say. So if I say DIFC, that should be interpreted to mean DIFC and or ADGM as appropriate. And then you need to think about things like, are you justifying the delegation on an objective criteria? To Phil's point, have you got sufficient resources on the ground in Dubai or Abu Dhabi to perform these activities? Are you ensuring that there is the ability for appropriate supervision by the FCA of what is of the activities which are being delegated, and have you delegated with all due care and attention? Those usual kind of analyses that you go through when you're adopting a delegation model. But you know, the reason we're here is just to say that the bolting on a Dubai regulated entity into or a Abu Dhabi regulated entity into your current structures is becoming an increasingly well trodden path. You know, one of our clients has had a UK MIFID firm and a DIFC firm for many years, but they've got more than one client with that model. And you know, some of those clients are doing portfolio management out of Dubai, and others are using the Dubai entity really as a sort of sales and rep office and a distribution and marketing function. There's probably one other tax point, which is to think about how the staff members who may be in the UK at the moment are going to be compensated and how they're going to be taxed when they pitch up in Dubai or Abu Dhabi. You can, I think, theoretically do, you know, dual hatting models where people have more than one employment contract, one for the work they're doing in the UK and one for the work they're doing in the Middle East. You just need to be very clear that you've kind of separated those roles. The reality of what we see more often than not is that people are just moving, you know, wholesale from the UK to Dubai or Abu Dhabi rather than worrying about whether they're going to, you know, try and split their total compensation into something which is caught by the UK tax net and something which is not caught by any tax net.
Yeah, just on that, just literally in the last, I think, 48 hours, the UAE tax authorities are now allowing individuals to apply for tax residency certificates to deal with this, because there's an acknowledgement now that there's so many expats moving to the UAE that they need to address this. And obviously corporate tax is being introduced in July this year for the first time ever. I think it's 9%. So,
but not, yeah, if you're based in DIFC, right?
It's, yeah, just I'm sure. That's right. There, when the DIFC and ADGM were created by decree, they were exempt from tax. There's zero tax, and so the decree says for 50 years companies will pay zero tax. But we were speaking with PwC and EY on this. There's still a little bit of uncertainty because there's so many financial there's free zones, they call them. DIFC ADGM are a little bit different because they're a financial free zone. So they have all their own financial services laws, where there's about 25 other free zones which have their own corporate law, but they don't have their own regulator, their own court system, etc. So I think the concern is that if none of the free zones are paying tax, then the UAE will be criticized for, you know, effectively no one's paying tax because everyone's in some kind of free zone. But we still think that the DIFC and ADGM should be exempt from corporate tax. And actually, that's another reason why a lot of companies are restructuring and coming into the center. Non-financial services companies are restructuring for that reason at the moment.
Right. So we'll turn now to marketing in the UAE. Before we go through the kind of key requirements, there's been an update, I think, to the ESCA rules, which govern the UAE area, which has quite a profound impact on the way in which you can market, yeah, both foreign and local funds in the UAE. So do you want to give a quick update on that, and then we can get into the meat of the,
yeah, the rules? Yeah. So as some of you may know, ESCA, the onshore regulator, threw a spanner in the works a few weeks ago. They came out with an amendment to their rule book. So all public offerings of foreign funds must cease immediately. And you can no longer register foreign funds with ESCA for a public offering. So we have clients with many, many UCITS funds, for example, when they're using banks to distribute those products in the UAE, they have to cease all operations immediately. So you can only register a foreign fund for a private offering now in the UAE, which means private placement to professional investors only. The regulations do actually make a note to say it is possible to set up a locally domiciled public feeder fund, which, so effectively you're indirectly offering your UCITS or other funds, you know, through the feeder fund. So again, this is a way for the UAE to encourage or force managers to set up locally in either onshore DIFC or ADGM. And the other thing to note was that there was a professional investor exemption, and the ESC has clarified that that's not available to offering funds. So it means that any kind of private placement, you need to be registering that with ESC unless you're doing some kind of cross-border. So I'll let Dunia talk.
Maybe just as we go through this section, I think you will see flavors of AIFMD coming through. The one difference which Phil's just touched on is that there is not yet, and hopefully there won't be, any equivalent to the fact that if you invest more than 85% of your assets in a non-in-scope fund, so let's say you have a DIFC fund which invests 100% into an underlying Cayman fund, that doesn't disqualify the feeder fund in the DIFC from having access to the marketing rules. Whereas, as you know, here, if I set up a Luxembourg fund which invested more than 85% of its assets in an underlying Cayman fund, then it wouldn't get access to the marketing passport. So there'll be lots of flavors of AIFMD, but that's sort of one difference. Yeah. Just for those of you trying to work out whether you can stick a feeder fund above a non-regional fund.
So Dunia is going to now take us through the key requirements applicable to managers marketing foreign funds first in the UAE.
So first of all, I would like to say that I'm very impressed to see so many people here and being interested in the region. Because when I relocated back 4 years ago from Paris, people were calling me crazy. So I'm very happy to see people are actually now interested in this region, because in my opinion, it's a fantastic place to live. It's very attractive for the youngest generation. And there's a lot of money. Investors are willing to deploy money. So that's very, very fascinating to see so many people being interested now. So in terms of marketing foreign funds, if you don't want to have a presence in the UAE, but you are still interested in marketing your foreign funds, you have two options. The first one is you can market on a pure cross-border basis. In this case, you won't be subject to the financial promotion rules, but you have certain do's and don'ts that you have to follow. Mainly, you cannot, so we suggest that fly-out visits last 2 to 3 days maximum. You cannot distribute fund documents. You cannot discuss a specific fund product. Any execution has to happen outside of the UAE. Subscription money received outside of the UAE. So there are certain do's and don'ts that you can do if you decide to market on a pure cross-border basis. The other option is, as mentioned by Phil, register for private offering with ESCA. So it has to be direct to professional investors and on a private placement basis only. It's interesting to note that now the definition of professional investor has been extended to some high net worth individuals. So any individuals with assets of at least, I think it's 4 million dirhams, so approximately $1 million, excluding the main residence, will be a qualified investor. The process to register is quite simple. The first requirement is to appoint a local distributor. But otherwise, the process is quite simple. Everything is online. You have to submit an application. Basically, it should include the PPM and some general information about the fund. It takes 2 to 3 weeks, I think, to get approval, approximately. We still have to test the new regime to see if they are receiving more and more requests, but usually 2 to 3 weeks. And the fee has been decreased to 10,000 dirhams. So it's approximately $2,500.
And what's the local distributor requirement? Do they have to kind of chaperone you in the area, or do they just have to be appointed to ensure that you've got some kind of supervision?
Yeah, I mean, they should. So promotion is a licensed activity, as I mentioned before. So fly in, fly out is okay. But yeah, if you're a lot of the clients who do this are speaking with the banks there's not many placement agents out in the region. There's a few individuals sort of running around, but it's the banks that do a lot of distribution. So a lot of the clients who actually register their funds is because they actually want the banks to actually.
So they will distribute the funds.
They'll actually.
So you can't, as a fund manager, go out and register for private placement and.
and do that. You can't be doing the promotion yourself. Right, you still have to do that on a fly-in, fly-out basis. Right. So that's sort of one of the negatives about this, that, you know, a lot of managers say, well, you know, I've got the relationship already. Why do I need to be paying a bank to do this? So I think most of the people who are registering are hiring the banks to actively market, and a lot of the banks will put on their, you know, distribute it to their private wealth clients, for example.
And when you come back, so on the fly-in, fly-out, when you come back to the UK, are you allowed to then distribute fund documents?
You should just do everything that you can do from your home office. So, you know, send PPN's marketing material before you go to the UAE, send it, you know, from your UK office, and just don't be physically distributing it while you're in the UAE.
A question that comes up a lot is reverse solicitation. Is that permitted in Dubai?
Yes. So there is a reverse solicitation exemption. So the contact has to be initiated by the investor, of course, and ideally be documented. It should be to professional investors only. And you will be exempted from the financial promotion rules.
Yeah. Yeah, actually, one of the other things that was updated was there previously was a government entity exemption. So if you were marketing to a sovereign wealth fund, for example, you weren't under any restrictions. So you could fly in, hand out physical hard copies of PPMs, do any kind of marketing that you want to sovereigns. That exemption for some reason, we think it was an oversight, but it's been completely removed from the new regulations. We have some of our clients are lobbying with ESC at the moment. We've got some feedback that ESC has verbally said, no, you can continue to market to governmental entities, and they wouldn't be taking any action on that. So there may be a further update to clarify that in the near future. So the only written exemption now is the reverse solicitation. It's hardwired into the regs.
And how much can you do from outside the UK without triggering kind of licensing requirements in Dubai?
Yeah, the ESC hasn't got guidance on this, but the DIFC, the DFSA has got in their guidance notes, they said that anything more than 3 consecutive days, they would consider you to have a license.
Okay, so Cayman funds, obviously they're back on the grey list. Has that had any impact in the UAE?
Yes. So
Dubai is also on the grey list, right?
UAE is on the grey list, and they are trying to get up the grey list. So recently it's in an internal policy, it's not in the rules, but they will refuse to register any fund that is incorporated or formed in a jurisdiction that is on the grey list of the FATF or the blacklist. But so the only fund jurisdiction is Cayman. So it will not be possible to register a Cayman fund at the moment. However, an alternative would be to set up your fund in another jurisdiction that is not on the grey or the blacklist, like Luxembourg or Ireland, for example, if you are targeting international investor, and the feeder will feed into the Cayman fund, and you will register this fund, the feeder, for private offering with ESCA.
And that's the thing that Chris was talking about earlier, is that in Europe and the UK, that would be a circumvention of the rules to have a Cayman fund and then have a European feeder to get around the marketing restrictions. But in UAE, you can do that.
So we don't think ESCA will look through. Actually, we don't think ESCA reads the PPM. So that's the thing, but it hasn't been tested yet.
Right.
So yeah. we don't know. But
interesting, we renewed, someone's in the audience, we renewed their Cayman funds for 2023. It was odd, it was only a couple of weeks ago. So they're not allowing new Cayman funds to register, but they allowed Cayman funds that were already registered to renew for 2023. But we suspect that they won't allow them to be renewed for 2024. It's slightly odd because we're speaking with clients who are saying, oh, well, we can set up in the BVI. And for some reason, you can do a BVI and register with ESCA, but not Cayman. So there's some alternatives that can be done. And, you know, we're speaking with Walkers and Maples, and they're assuring us that Cayman's going to get off the grey list by September. I think they've just got one more item to satisfy by September. So I guess the question is, you know, do clients restructure now, set up a DIFC fund to register or another fund, and go through that time and effort only for Cayman to be back off the grey list in September, and then ESCO will presumably allow it to be registered. So these are some of the conversations that we're having at the moment.
And we had a client fairly recently where we were under a lot of pressure from the regulator to try and set up a local fund instead of a Cayman fund. And, you know, it's kind of important when, in the context of raising capital on a global basis, you need to be able to raise money from outside the Middle East as well as in the Middle East. So it was quite interesting. There was a bit of, we actually had the regulator asking us lots of questions and suggesting that a local fund would be the right option. But, you know, we think Cayman will survive.
Yeah, I think so. I think, you know, going back 6 or 7 years, I think 95% of the funds that we would set up would be Cayman structures. And over the last couple of years, we've seen a shift towards a more regulated product like you've seen in Europe. And so, yeah, a lot more, probably 50% of the funds that we're setting up now are DIFC or ADGM funds, and the other 50% would be still be Cayman structures.
So it's quite a niche question, but a lot of what we do from London is managed accounts. So what's the ability to market potential managed accounts with investors in the region?
Yeah, so that can be done on a cross-border basis like you would offer a fund product. But actually, interesting, the professional investor exemption that's available, it's not available for funds, but it should be available for offering, you know, managed accounts and financial services. So assuming that you're just marketing financial services to professional investors as it's defined, then you're free to market that.
Great. So we're now moved to kind of local products. Before we get into the actual marketing requirements, perhaps, Dunya, if you could just explain the differences, high level detail between DIFC local funds, ESCA funds, and ADGM funds.
So in terms of jurisdiction, the most popular one is DIFC, definitely because it's sophisticated, attractive. It's easy to hire people and relocate them to Dubai, because again, it's a great place to live. The reason why you would set up in ADGM, if again, as Phil mentioned, if you're targeting sovereigns and they will ask you to actually be set up there and move your team there, again, with a view to boost the region, because there's competition between ADGM and DIFC, so that they are trying to get there. Onshore funds are really not popular, to say the least. We've done one in 4 years. The only reason why you would set up there is it's for commercial reasons, if you are targeting specific investors or you have a very specific investment strategy, because it's not attractive for international investors. Because as we mentioned, basically the funds entity are contractual arrangements rather than what you will see in Europe, like LPs and investment companies. So the documents have to be in Arabic. Again, they are trying to get there. That's the goal with all the updates they are doing. But you will not consider typically onshore UAE for funds.
Great. So marketing these products, how does one go about marketing these kind of local products? I think there's a passporting regime in the UAE generally.
Yes. So they have tried to mimic the European system by implementing a passporting regime. So basically, there is an MOU between the three jurisdictions. And if you set up a fund in, let's say, DIFC or ADGM or onshore UAE, you are able to passport it into the other jurisdictions and to market the fund to the investors in those jurisdictions. So the process is very simple. It's online, takes a couple of days. So the idea, again, is to boost the local market and give access to investors across the UAE.
Yeah. And just on that, so we're speaking with a number of managers who had previously, you know, had, say, several UCITS funds registered with ESCA for public offering to retail clients. And effectively, the only way around that now is to set up, say, a DIFC manager and set up a DIFC public feeder fund, I think, as I mentioned before. So again, we're getting a lot of inquiries from large US and European managers to do this. So yeah, as I mentioned, so if you were going to register a fund with ESCA, we mentioned that you needed a locally licensed distributor, whereas under the passporting regime, you don't need a locally licensed distributor onshore in the UAE. So it's quite a big advantage.
So I think we'll finish with the actual local products themselves and how to structure them. So in terms of the key features, the key requirements, the process, the timing, the products available in the DIFC, ADGM, and the ESCA UAE, what's the kind of like key things to think about?
Yeah, so all of the structures that you find in Ireland or Luxembourg are available in the DIFC and ADGM. So companies, limited partnerships, trusts, arrangements. And then there's a variety of different licenses of funds. So you have the Qualified Investor Fund, which is pretty much exempt from all the regulations. And they really created that to compete with, say, Cayman funds. So they can be created within a week or two. And the costs are roughly the same as setting up in Cayman. And then you step up to an exempt fund. And then they also have a public fund, which is effectively the equivalent of like a UCITS type fund. So you have all the structures that you would find in Europe.
Great. Before we move to questions, we're actually joined by Peter Litvin, who works with Lakemore, who's just gone through the process. And Peter's kindly agreed to just talk about lessons learned, the process, your kind of feelings of the application and licensing arrangements. So maybe, Peter, you can give a few minutes.
I would definitely echo what Dooney was saying, that the UAE have, back in the day, you got paid danger money to go over there, right? You know, it was a different lifestyle. If you want to move your family, it wasn't something that you were used to. I think in the last probably 5 years or so, the UAE have created a lifestyle for expats where people sort of enjoy the life out there. You know, you can bring your family, the education system's pretty good. You know, my two sons were out there initially when they were about 9 and 11, and they went through maybe 6-7 years of education out there before they went back to the UK to board over here. But the lifestyle generally has improved considerably, where, you know, back in the day, after sort of, you used to have this sort of 5 or 7 year itch, where after that period of time, it was like, right, I've done my thing, I'm, you know, time to move back to the UK. Whereas now my friends in the UK say, please, Peter, don't come back. Stay where you are.
I should have disclosed, by the way, we're being sponsored by the UAE.
Yeah.
It feels like that anyway.
So as I say, they created a lifestyle. I mean, it goes all the way back probably 35, 40 years ago, the airline. You know, Sheikh Zayed was very sort of, you know, a lot of foresight in creating that. And with that, the lifestyle, et cetera. So, you know, I've been out there now. So brief background, I was at Citigroup. I was the chief financial officer for their alternative investment division in London, New York. So I did my time at Citi. And then I wanted to do my next role a bit differently. So I took a role where I was setting them up in the Middle East. So I initially went to the Middle East in 2010 to Bahrain, and I was there for a couple of years, and then I moved to Dubai. And as Craig was saying, I set up a private equity firm, went through everything Chris and Phil and Dooney were saying. It's a very different regulator. They've clearly got far too much time on their hands, which is can be very frustrating, but they're very professional. It's a very professional regulated environment. And I've seen over the years, so for the last 9 years, I've run an advisory firm with clients in the UAE. I've helped set them up, raise capital, et cetera. And things have changed quite a lot in that period. And whether it's the DIFC, DFSA in Dubai or ADGM in Abu Dhabi, it's a very professionally run regulatory environment. And therefore, it's attractive all the names that you've said more recently. And it is a combination of reasons, in my view. One, you know, as Dooney was saying, in Abu Dhabi, yes, you've got the sovereigns. And they do. They knock on your door and they say, you're a big manager. You come over here. You bring $100 million in the CEO. And we'll raise another $100 million for you. And they have done. But it's always, as you all know, far easier. It sounds far easier than it is in reality, right? They don't do that often. But that's an attraction for Abu Dhabi. DIFC is more of a lifestyle thing. People like living there. a lot more than they do in Abu Dhabi. Different tastes and different lifestyles. But you know, there's a lot of money in the region, as you all know, right? Otherwise, you wouldn't be here. I mean, there's a combination of reasons one would want to re-domicile in the UAE. There's a lot of family money in the UAE. There's a lot of family money in Abu Dhabi and Dubai. There's a huge amount beyond all of our estimations across the border in Saudi Arabia. And the Saudis love the DIFC and ADGM because it's a recognized regulatory environment. Now, they are keen on building their own regulatory environment, but nonetheless, if you say you have a fund or a fund manager domiciled in DIFC or ADGM, it's very well recognized in Saudi, and therefore you can attract sort of whether it's family office money or institutional money, sovereign money from Saudi for UAE-based managers. So it leads to quite an attractive proposition. And like the guys were saying, you've just now got managers, I assume, including you guys, who want a different lifestyle. You know, you're perhaps a bit fed up with the fiscal policies in the UK and Northern Europe and the cold weather that I try and avoid coming over this time of year. And, you know, you know, from a personal perspective, there's no income tax. There's VAT about is 5%. And as the guys were saying, there's going to be corporation tax, but the corporation tax can be mitigated, I think, to quite an extent, especially in the free zones. And, you know, there's no capital gains, there's no tax. So from a lifestyle perspective, you know, I looked at it 12 years ago and thought, well, I can earn double the amount of money in the UAE as I can in the UK. It's as simple as that. So, and I think things will change. It all ultimately depends on the price of oil, right? So when the price of oil dropped a few years ago, suddenly the UAE started looking at their sort of tax regimes, and that's when VAT was brought in, etc. Oil's gone back up now through $70, and therefore there's less need. But, you know, I think in time, tax rates will only be going in one direction. Mm. I think, you know, people need to be aware of that when they're looking to sort of re-domicile. But I think I'll just wrap up by saying that from a regulatory perspective, you know, the asset management business has been built up over the last 10, 15 years. It's very well established. There's some very, very good blue chip service providers, a couple of them in the room I noticed today, people that can offer you efficiencies. So as Phil was saying, you can outsource compliance, you can outsource a finance officer role. So when you first start, it can be quite efficient because the regulator is quite happy for you to do that. I think they even encourage it because it means you've got someone who knows a little bit about the regulations and about the sort of financial control rules and so forth. So it facilitates perhaps an easier ride in terms of getting the license, whether it's sitting on a platform or outsourcing those types of roles. So all in all, I've dealt with Chris and Phil for 10 years plus, and I think that you know, they to me are one of the sort of blue chip providers who not only understand the rules but actually have deep relationships with the regulator, with, you know, other people in the region, and that really helps because I think, you know, unlike the FCA, it actually depends who you get to do your application at the regulator here. So, you know, the personalities make a difference.
I think I sent Peter an invoice yesterday. He's looking for a discount.
Good.
No, thank you. Appreciate that, Peter. So I think we're open to questions now. Is there any in the room?
Are you seeing much appetite for entrepreneurs? Openings rather than the
disruption
that
Junior
mentioned?
So branch for rep officers, yes. But I think if you're going to have real operations, then we would always advise you to have a subsidiary from a liability perspective rather than a branch, just to segregate your assets and liabilities. But it is possible, but we don't see that very often. It's only usually with for firms setting up a rep office would be a branch. Yeah,
I think I would say the conversations I've had have been focused really on the portfolio management side
or well, not non-marketing side. Mm-hmm. So people who are on the portfolio management function, just wanting to work from a more favorable jurisdiction. And that's become the main kind of topic recently.
Yeah, doing a branch, it doesn't really, I mean, the only advantage is that you can rely on the capital requirements of the home office. But in terms of getting the license, it's not going to be any quicker by doing a branch rather than a new subsidiary. Yeah.
And actually, people are relocating and setting up fund manager in the region. We're working on how many applications recently. It's booming. So people are actually willing to come to the UAE rather than just work on a purely cross-border basis.
I would say from a marketing perspective, it's quite an interesting place to be because it sits in a jurisdiction which is acceptable to Europe and the US, but it's also acceptable to Asia and Russia. And so it kind of sits in a kind of neutral place where, in terms of attracting money on a global basis, it's quite interesting.
It's convenient, right? You're in the middle of all the time zones.
Yep.
I'm not sure the exact number. I've heard numbers from between 200 and 300,000 Russians have moved to Dubai in the last 12 months. So property prices have doubled. It really is booming without exaggerating. We speak with our Hong Kong office and on a regular basis, you know, Hong Kong managers looking to either entirely relocate to Dubai or at least have a second office in Dubai sort of to mitigate risk.
And that was a surprise actually, because when Hong Kong had its political issues, we sort of expected them to move to Singapore, but a lot of them, if not the majority, have gone actually to the UAE.
Yeah. And even managers in Singapore are looking at Dubai as an option, particularly during COVID, although I think they've passed a lot of those issues now. But I think even a lot of French managers and family offices are moving. We're seeing a lot of German.
Probably worth noting, not many US, because if you're a US taxpayer, you have to pay tax wherever you are. So
yeah.
But people still relocate now.
Really?
For the lifestyle, because it's safe. It's tolerant. There's no tension. The society is peaceful. Mm-hmm. So you actually see Americans coming to Dubai even though they have to pay taxes in the US, which shows how attractive the jurisdiction is now. And there is a really pre-COVID and post-COVID. The way they handled the situation was incredible, as opposed to Europe and the US. So literally, after COVID, they have attracted so many people. It's incredible.
Hi, I've been in the region now for over 15 years and would probably echo what everybody's been saying here about the change and the pace and everything that's happening. And I think most people, when you talk to them, are very familiar with DIFC Dubai. Are you finding now that people that have set up in the region already, they're already in, say, the DIFC, are actually now interested in setting up in the ADGM as well? Or are you finding that there's different people going to different jurisdictions, so there's a preference kind of thing?
Yeah, I think it's we have some clients who are a licensed in both jurisdictions, but you know, it's literally an hour's drive, as you know. So, you know, to go through the expense and time and effort twice is probably, you know, it's not necessary unless there's a driver. And it's usually been managers who've been in the DIFC for a number of years. But then, you know, to get Mubadala or Adia to invest that 100 million there, they said, please come down to the ADGM. So that's where often you see them having in both jurisdictions. I think, funnily enough, I think that the place where everyone's also looking at the moment, whether they're already in DIFC or ADGM or not, is Saudi. And so we've had a number of DIFC managers getting a CMA license in the last year or two as well. I think the CMA and the government in Saudi sort of keep sort of threatening that, you know, if you're not in Saudi in the next 12 months, you're going to be shut off. We don't know if that will actually happen. But, yeah, I think a lot of managers are scrambling to set up in Saudi at the moment as well. I think, you know, I think historically people, you know, 15 years ago, you know, people were based in Bahrain and just crossing the border into Saudi. But I think now most people would be probably either in Abu Dhabi or Dubai and flying in and out of Saudi. But I think with NEOM and other projects in Saudi, they're trying to attract people as well. So.
Yeah, and I think also, I think DFSA in particular, they're quite stringent on the whole double hatting thing. So I guess, you know, if you're going to be based there, you really need to think about where it is you actually set up, because you may, if you want two offices, it means two SEOs, two compliance officers, and that's quite an investment as well.
Yeah, so that's right. So we set up a client in ADGM, and they wouldn't allow the SEO of DIFC to also be the SEO of ADGM. So it was actually the general counsel that actually became the SEO of the Abu Dhabi entity for that reason. Yeah.
Any other questions?
Time for tea and dates.
Yep. Thank you for coming. Appreciate it, Tom.
Thank you.